everybody, happy Easter. We're so glad that you're here at the Ridge today. We're going to stand, we're going to lift our voices because our God is worthy of all praise today. So let's sing out to Him who's worthy. Come on.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger?
This morning to stand amazed in the presence of our God who's with us. Let's lift our voice and sing this to Him.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene.
all church, just sing this out.
Sing, how marvelous and how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous and how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
We sing this truth of the gospel this morning. He took my sins and my sorrows.
He took my sins and my sorrows, and he made them his very own. He bore my burden to Calvary, where he suffered and died alone.
He's worthy of all our praise. We lift our voice and sing.
Sing it. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone.
Because I know. Jesus is alive this morning, church. Let's give him praise. Come on.
Yeah.
Church, we don't get too many opportunities in our lifetime with a couple thousand people to lift high the name of Jesus. So on this side of eternity, we need to take advantage of every moment that we get the opportunity to do this. So here's what we're going to do. One more time. We're going to sing that chorus, but like top of our lungs. City of Austin needs Jesus. We get an opportunity to echo the name of Jesus in this place this morning. So with everything we've got, we sing, come on. And praise the Father. Come on, church. God, there's no one that's like you. And the work that you've done with Jesus on the cross was for us. And we thank you. We thank you that we're no longer bound by sin and shame. We thank you that you have given us a Savior, that you had a plan for salvation for us. And we thank you that not only did Jesus take upon himself on the cross our sin and shame, but he rose again victorious over sin and death. God, we are so thankful that Jesus is alive and we are now alive in Christ. Thank you for that. That is the good news of the gospel that we celebrate together today. God, we love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's give God some praise this morning, church. Come on.
Man, church, y'all sound good this morning. Now that we know y'all can do that, we do expect that every week. That was loud. Happy Easter, guys. If y'all are here for the first time, y'all have been checking us out for a while, or if your family drug you here to that once-a-year service, we are excited that you're in the house with us today. We have a QR code in between each seat. We also, if you're old school, have a paper copy of our Connect card, and we would just encourage y'all to fill that out and turn it in. What that does is it gives us a chance to reach out, to say hey, and to tell you about all the ways that we have to get you plugged in here, because we have a place for you. We want you to be a part of our Ridge family, and so we just want to get to tell you about that. And so there's no commitment other than us just reaching out and saying hey and telling you that we love you and we have a place for you here. If you have questions about Christianity in general, or if you want some clarification, or even if you just want an overview, we get to offer a one-day class next Sunday. It's called Intro to Christianity. It's on this campus. It's at 9 o'clock. And what it is it's just a chance for us to get to tell you about Christianity, tell you about why we love Jesus, and answer any questions that you may have. So check that out. Register online. It's completely free, and we want to see you there. Last but not least, we talk a lot on stage and off about how often we as a team and staff, and just even people who have been here for a while, see God at work. We get to meet new people every week. And one of those things that I call a privileged problem is parking is a little crazy. And I'm sure a lot of y'all experience that on the way in. And I can guarantee you that you will all experience that on the way out. We want to tell you that we acknowledge it, we see it, and we're trying to be part of the solution. So what we've done is our Westlake exit is now a one-way all the way out. So you can turn left in both lanes. And then if you need to go to Lakeway, you can use the right lane to turn right. So we're trying to make it as simple as possible. We know y'all are bringing in a lot of people. There's a lot of dynamics and family. So we want to try being part of that solution. But we do encourage y'all to be patient with each other, be gracious with each other, and we'll get you out of here as simply as we can. One thing we love to do here is celebrate people's stories and celebrate the way that God is moving. So y'all check out the screens as we continue to worship this morning.
Previously, I would say faith was a little bit more of a spiritual crutch for those who needed it, right? They didn't understand how things worked, and it's like magic or whatnot. I didn't know if there was such a thing as faith or not, but I wasn't pro or con, I would say, faith of any sort. My parents are immigrants. They're from Hong Kong, and then they moved here for mostly academic medical training. So I was born in the States, but very typical immigrant family, worked hard, went to school, all that. Everybody in my family is scientifically, sort of medically oriented, lots of physicians, lots of scientists. So from my point of view, it is all about science and how the world worked, very logical, very objective, in some sense, fact-based or evidence-based. When I got to Stanford, everybody there is pretty smart, and some of these very smart people self-proclaimed to have faith, and I thought, well, that's interesting. They've thought about this. Being the scientist I was, I actually went to every major religion small group on campus, and for the better part of my freshman year, I went to all these groups and I asked all the questions. I mean, I was asking myself, how is this consistent with science, right? You know, a lot of basic evolution questions and Genesis questions, a lot of questions around free will and not free will. But what I ultimately learned is you can't actually prove yourself into faith. And so I got to this point where I felt like I had probably as much academic knowledge as one would have about any of the major religions, and you're sort of standing on the precipice of faith at that point. Like, you either take a leap of faith or you don't. I've had this full day of misfortune in some sense, but maybe more importantly, I'm clearly not in control. And so I'm sitting on my bed, wondering what to do, and I get this knock on my door, and the person at the door is actually on staff at what was then called Campus Crusade, now I think it's called CRU, and he says, hi, my name's Lewis. You went to an event 4 or 5 weeks ago and filled out a form saying you would love a visitor. It's like, what are you doing? I'm like, well, I'm actually not doing anything. So we chat for at least an hour. Now, to be fair, I've heard all of it. I've, of course, been offered many times and asked many times, would you like to pray, and so forth. But for some reason, maybe it's obvious now in retrospect, I was much more open to hearing it. And at the end, he asks, you know, would you like to pray and receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? And for the first time, I thought, absolutely. And so I actually got down on my knees. I remember praying on my bed and prayed to receive Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. What was so interesting to me in retrospect is I spent all this time talking to friends, trying to understand it, but it's really like they're describing their best friend and they can describe how tall or short he or she is and what color their eyes are and so forth. But until you actually meet them and have that relationship, you don't really get it. And so I took that, I guess, step of faith, and now it's almost like I'm looking back and it seems a lot more obvious, but it was obviously a life-changing moment for me. The journey has been, some parts have been very steep in my learning, and then to be fair, you know, now I've been a Christian for more than 30 years, some have plateaued and then sometimes it grows and so forth. But I've been really fortunate to have a great community of brothers and sisters along the way. And a few things I would say that God has constantly sort of laid upon sort of my life and my journey, which is the fact that he's sovereign, right? For me, you know, I run an investment firm and I happen to have the privilege of serving on a lot of boards. My day job is involved with trying to exert some sort of influence and control on the outcome of our companies or our investments. But what I have learned is I'm actually not in control, and that God is in control. Once I became a Christian, the purpose now is all around kingdom building and having that sort of impact in the world. I think that it's really important to make sure you have the foundational information, but at the end of the day, faith is faith. Faith is not a scientific algorithm. When you take that step, the experience you have is so different than when you just have the sort of intellectual information, and it's a experiential, relational faith. And so I would encourage them to take that leap of faith. And the other part, which I think has been really helpful, is to have people who you know and trust there to sort of support you in your journey.
How are we doing, church? I want to say good morning to our Dripping campus, our Southwest campus. I want to say good morning to our fourth campus, our balcony. I want to say good morning to our folks out in the foyer. We got folks out there. I want to say good morning to our folks in Building A. We have folks sitting in Building A and watching as well. So glad you're here. Thanks for spending time with us. We're going to be in Acts chapter 8. I have so much in common with that story. I, too, when I was 15, was called by Stanford to come and study. I turned it down. I went back to high school. It's an incredible story because, much like Gerhong, I came to faith my freshman year in college, and I went to all the Christian organizations just like he did, and I'm sure he asked better questions than I asked, but same journey, and the resurrection changes everything. Every other religious in the history of the world, you can still go to their tomb, and there's still a body in it. You go to the tomb of Christ, there's no body. It changes everything. It separates Christianity from being a religion. It is a true spirituality of following a person, not a set of rules, not about behavior modification. It is about following Jesus. This past Monday, I had a funeral I did here at the Ridge. One of my dear friends, Jo Frederick, and she's one of the godliest people I've ever known. She probably led more people to Christ than I'll ever lead, disciple more people I'll ever disciple. Here's what Easter means. I will miss Jo, but I know exactly where she is. I haven't lost her. And I'll be where she is, and her faith is now sight. The resurrection changes all of that. If the resurrection takes away the fear of death, we have nothing else to fear as believers. Another way of saying that is this. If you're a Christian, this right here is as bad as it's ever going to get. If you're not a Christian, this right here is as good as it's ever going to get. So we're going to jump into the text, and we've already been in the book of Acts since last year, so if you're new to our church or you're a guest here today, we're going to jump right back into Acts chapter 8, and I'm going to tell you a story of a guy I think really fits the Easter message. So what is the message or the mission of Easter? I believe it's what Jesus said to his disciples right before he left. He said, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes, and you will be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and Judea. So where they live, Judea is like Travis County, and even Samaria, that's the folks you don't like. You'll be a witness to people you don't even enjoy talking to. And then he said this, and to the end of the earth. Now, I don't think those guys were ready to carry out that mission. They had no understanding of what that even meant. To a Jewish mind, the end of the earth at that time would have been maybe Spain. If we're going to go in the text today, and we're going to go to truly the ends of the earth, to the Greek mind during that time, that they never would have thought, why would you ever go past the point that we're going to see in the text today? We're going to see for the first time in the book of Acts a non-Jewish person convert to be a Jesus-following person. You with me? You guys look so nice. Chapter 8 of Acts, verse 26. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, rise and go toward the south, to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert place. Now, people often ask, how do you know if God has spoken to you? It's usually not verbally, but you get inspired, you get convicted. He lays things on your heart. I don't know exactly how the angel of the Lord spoke to him here. It could have been verbal, but I do know this. Philip must have spent a lot of time with the Lord because the Lord speaks to him often. And I want you to rise and I want you to go south. Now, the road to Gaza was built by the Roman Empire. It's a road that would go from Jerusalem all the way down to Egypt, where the deserts were. And if you go past that on the Gaza road, it would go past Egypt down south to a place called Ethiopia. Ethiopia, to the Jewish mind, was the end of the earth. To a Greek mind, Homer's Iliad, he said of the Ethiopian people, it is the men at the end. Meaning there's nothing. You cannot go any further away than going down on the road to Gaza, down south. So the angel of the Lord tells them to go south to a desert place. I don't know if you're from Lubbock, but you know exactly what the angel was saying to Philip. I want you to go to the desert place. And I want you to go to a place that most people around you will never understand why you're going there. Let me ask a question here. Can God know you? Does he have your heart enough to ask you to go somewhere? And he's not going to give you the details of what's going to happen when you get there, who you're going to talk to, what you're going to say, what you're going to do. And can you trust him enough to send you to a desert place, maybe a desert season in your life. And you're going to see here that Philip asks zero questions of the Lord. He just does it. Every time the Lord speaks, he just does it, which I think is a great lesson for us. I think a lot of times our lives will get easier if we just do what God tells us today to do. Oftentimes we're worried about tomorrow. Do today what God has told us to do. And that's exactly what Philip is going to do. I also want you to see in this story, you're going to see a lot of coincidences. Philip's going to go to a certain place at a certain time, a certain person's going to be coming by and he's going to be reading a certain text, and then God's going to tell him, I want you to talk to that person. I believe with the Lord, there is no coincidence. Many things happening, incidents all at the same time. I believe with God, everything is certain. I don't believe it's coincidence that you're here today. I don't believe it's coincidence that I'm speaking today. I don't believe it's coincidence that we happen to be in this text today from the book of Acts. I believe God has something he wants your heart to hear today. And it's not just that it's Easter. He wants you to hear. He wants all of your heart. So verse 27. And he rose and went, and there was an Ethiopian, a eunuch, a court official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of all her treasure. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning, seated in his chariot, and he was reading the prophet Isaiah. Now, in antiquity, a eunuch was someone who would stand watch over the king's harem. So the king would appoint him, felt like that was a safe move. Ancient Ethiopia, it's interesting, when you study ancient Ethiopia, the kings were not seen as humans like you and I are. The kings were seen as God in human form. So a king in Ethiopia, he would reign, but he would not rule. What I mean by that is he would be the man in charge, but he did not run the day-to-day administration of the king to see to all the needs that had to happen, because he was so holy that was underneath him as the king to have to worry about something to do on a Tuesday. So here's the picture. You've got the king who thinks he's God. Now, I hope that doesn't get too familiar with some of you. Thinks he's God. Now he's got a wife. She's called the what? What is the king's wife called? The queen. Her name, it says here, is Candace. Now, the thing about Ethiopian queens, they weren't given names. They were given titles. So in Ethiopia, the king's wife, the queen, even though the king reigned, the queen was actually in charge and she ruled the nation. And the title given to her was Candace, much like Rome would give the title to their leader Caesar, much like Egypt would give a title to their leaders Pharaoh. And so Candace was the ruler of Ethiopia under her godlike husband, and now you have a eunuch who works for her, and she trusts this man to put all the treasury of Ethiopia under his control. He runs the bank of Ethiopia. Are you following me? So this guy is coming to Jerusalem to worship. Why? Why would an Ethiopian eunuch come to Jewish territory, to Jerusalem, to worship on this time of the year? Why? Well, if you remember your Old Testament, there was another Ethiopian, another queen, Queen of Sheba. The Ethiopian people in antiquity were called the Sabaean people. She was the queen of Sheba, the queen of the Sabaean people. She was the Ethiopian queen who came to talk to King Solomon in Jerusalem because she had heard about his wisdom and his grandeur and his insight, and she came all the way to Jerusalem to get wisdom from King Solomon. The Bible says that she was blessed by King Solomon. She went back, and she was a blessing to the Ethiopian people. Now, this is my opinion, what I'm about to tell you. I believe, in my opinion, that this man grew up in Ethiopia hearing about Queen Sheba, hearing about the blessing that she received from the Jewish people in a certain place called Jerusalem from the leader who could tell about God and creation and all these things, and it blessed their nation. I believe this man grew up hearing that, and for whatever reason, he had gone to Jerusalem to worship to find more wisdom, to get more answers. We would call him today in church world a seeker. Have you heard that word before? A seeker is someone that may not be a Jesus-following person, but they're curious. They're seeking things. They're asking questions. They wonder. They want to know more. And so I believe this man is the classic seeker going to the place where you go to get answers about God when you want to learn more about him. Now, in Jerusalem, eunuchs were not allowed to serve in any capacity in the synagogue. So now you need to understand, Ethiopian eunuch, you have in those two words, if this guy can come to Christ and be saved, anybody can. This guy is as far away from the place of truth that you could possibly live on the outermost parts of the earth. And this man was a eunuch, could not even serve in the synagogue. If God can get this guy, God can get anybody. Is there somebody that you're praying for that you wonder if they'll ever soften their heart and turn and follow the Lord? And you just wonder what miracle it's going to take? If God can get the Ethiopian eunuch, matter of fact, if God got you, he can get anybody, right? We always say, if you knew about me what I know about me, you wouldn't listen to me preach. If I knew about you what you know about you, we wouldn't let you in the door, right? So when I think about when I was at Clemson, I was a freshman at Clemson, the Elite Eight Clemson team. When I was at Clemson, I came to Christ my freshman year, and I started working with athletes. I started working through the Fellowship of Christian Athletes with the football team. And I got a chance through Coach Ken Hatfield, our head coach, who was a believer, access to the football team. And when I got saved my freshman year at Clemson, I grew up Southern Baptist. You got any Southern Baptists here? Yeah, they don't like to say anything out loud in church. You know? Woo, that's me. I grew up going to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. I had a drug problem. I was drugged to church every time the doors were open. So when I came to Christ my freshman year at Clemson, no one at Clemson marveled that this Baptist kid from up the road is now following Jesus. Not a big deal. But then we saw a quarterback come to faith. That was kind of a big deal. Then we saw a deist professor in the history department at Clemson convert and follow Jesus as a deist. And then people around campus started marveling. We saw a defensive back come to faith. We saw a running back come to faith. Why am I telling you all this? Then we saw who is the Ethiopian eunuch come to faith. We saw an outside linebacker come to faith. Now, you got to understand something about outside linebackers. They love hitting people. They're not all there, right? And I was going around the athletic dorm one day, and I walked into a room, and I knew whose room it was. It was a guy named LaVon Kirkland. LaVon Kirkland played several years for the Pittsburgh Steelers. He was about 6'7", about 280, and was faster than me. I knew that. And I walked in, and I still don't know this day. I think I had a card that he had filled out on something. So I walked in his dorm room, and LaVon stood up, and he kept standing up, and he kept standing up. And I imagine what I sounded like, LaVon, can I talk to you? And I started talking about the Lord to LaVon, and LaVon told me, he says, my dad's a pastor. I was like, oh, great, you're one of us. And I don't know if LaVon was walking the Lord then. I don't know when he started walking the Lord, but LaVon got saved. And LaVon is now a coach at Clemson, and I hear he loves Jesus and walks with the Lord. If God can get an outside linebacker, God can get anybody you're praying for. Whoever you're praying for, I promise you, they're not stronger than the Lord. So this man had come to Jerusalem to worship, much like people come to church on Easter. Much like people come to church on Christmas Eve. Our numbers double on Easter and Christmas Eve, sometimes triple. I believe a lot of people are seeking, and they come. And this man went to the place that you would go to find out. You go to Jerusalem, where the Jewish people have a divine book that they can tell you who God is. Now, every once in a while in my job, I get to do weddings. I don't do a lot of weddings because weekends have gotten more and more busy for me here at the Ridge. But when you do a wedding, sometimes someone may ask you, could we use this scripture in our wedding? And one of the scriptures I have to have a conversation over is, let me tell you the context of that. It's not a great wedding passage. Maybe you've heard it at a wedding. Where you go, I will go. Your people will be my people. Wherever you die, I will die. Now, that's great. That comes from the book of Ruth, okay? So Ruth had lost her husband. She was a Moabite, non-Jewish. She's saying this to her mother-in-law, who's Jewish, and she's saying, wherever you go, I will go. Your people will be my people. Wherever your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die. Now, unless you're a Gentile bride marrying a Jewish man and you're converting to Judaism during that ceremony, that's a great text. The point is this, in the Old Testament, if you're going to follow the God of Israel, you have to take on the people of Israel, okay? Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. Wherever you go, I will go. Another example of that in your Old Testament, Naaman the Syrian. We studied him. We studied the life of Elisha the prophet. Naaman wakes up one day, has leprosy. And his second in charge says, hey, I know a guy in Israel. They say he can heal people. Let's go see him. So he takes all this money to Elisha the prophet, puts all this money out there. Elisha won't even come to the door to answer the door, sends a servant to the door. The servant says, here's what Elisha says you need to do. Go bathe 7 times, dip yourself 7 times in the Jordan River. Why did Elisha say that? What's the Jordan River? The Jordan River is connected to the Jewish people. When you think Jewish people, the Jordan. When you think of the Jordan, you think of Jewish people. Here's what Elisha's saying. You have to take on the people of God to understand who God is. Now, Naaman the Syrian didn't want to do it. He said, we've got more beautiful bodies of water in Syria. Why should I bathe myself in dirty Jordan River? I imagine his second charge says something like, well, our rivers don't heal people. He goes 7 times, he comes out, 7 times he comes out, no leprosy, clean as a baby's bottom, skin glistening. What's the point? If you're going to understand the God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, you have to take on the people of that God to understand who that is. That's why this man is going to Jerusalem to a synagogue, because he's trying to figure out who this God is. Now, it's interesting. In Jerusalem, the synagogue was run by the Pharisees. The Pharisees were religious people who had crucified Jesus recently, 2 months earlier. Just crucified him, reject him. So the synagogue, the light is no longer on. You know what I'm saying? So in the synagogue, you have people, Jesus called them blind guides. You had people taking the divine scriptures and reading truth about who the coming Messiah is, and they had just rejected the coming Messiah, and he is now crucified. So is it possible today that there are people who stand on stages much like this one telling you what the Word of God says, and the light in their own heart is not even understanding what they're talking about, and they're trying to tell other people who are seeking to find the truth? This man had just gone to the synagogue in Jerusalem, and he left with more questions than when he got there. Let's go back to verse 29. And the Spirit said to Philip, go over and join the chariot. I don't know how fast a horse-drawn chariot is, but look what Philip does. He runs. So Philip ran to him and heard him reading Isaiah the prophet and asked, do you understand what you are reading? What a great question. Folks, what we do here at Austin Ridge is we ask you, do you understand? Do you understand who Jesus is? Not who culture says Jesus is. Do you understand? Not who your grandma said Jesus is. Do you understand why the tomb being empty is such a big deal? Do you understand? And this man is asked a question by Philip, and I think it's a wonderful question. Verse 31, and he said, how can I unless someone guides me? And he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. Now, Philip could have said, well, you're just coming back from the synagogue. What do you mean, guide you? They don't know what they're talking about either. They don't have any answers to this truth. They have turned the light off. Philip understands the answer to the passage he's going to read here in a second. Here's what I want you to get. As Christians, the light is turned on. We understand. We have insider trading that the rest of the world does not understand. The Christian understands what no philosopher can ever understand. The Christian understands what no professor can understand. The Christian understands what no governing official can ever understand. The Christian understands because we have insider trading, because the spiritual eyes have been opened and the Spirit of God lives inside of us. That is why Easter is such a big deal. We get the opportunity to be Philip to the world. And the world may not ask, how can I understand? But the world is seeking. And we one day have to open our mouth and speak. Before I was a Christian, if you had said the word history to me, I would have said, nap. No desire to study history whatsoever. You would never see me watch a documentary. I didn't know what that word meant, a documentary. Now that I'm a Christian, fascinated with history. Here's what history is. It's mankind doing the same thing over and over and over, same outcome, over and over and over, same outcome. And it fascinates me now, because as you see it through spiritual eyes, through an empty tomb, now you see history, and it makes complete sense that man without God always leads to the same place, which is utter confusion and chaos. Before I was a Christian, if you'd mentioned the word philosophy to me, I had no interest whatsoever. Why do I want to listen to a bunch of people talk about what they think about something? When I became a Christian, all of a sudden I was fascinated with philosophy, because I'm fascinated that a group of people can sit around and talk about divine questions, trying to come up with divine answers, leaving God out of the conversation. which is fascinating to me. We call it philosophy. And now Philip can tell a man what no one else can tell him, and we get to do the same thing as a church, and that is why what we do here every week is so important. Not just Easter. Do you understand? How can I unless someone guides me? I believe what Philip was reading, and I'll tell you why. He's reading the book of Isaiah. I believe Philip is reading, the Ethiopian eunuch's reading from the book of Isaiah in his chariot. I believe he was at the synagogue, and I believe in the synagogue, that's the text they were reading, and he's reading again, trying to figure out what in the world this text means. Let's look at the text that he's reading in his chariot. Verse 32. Now the passage of the scripture that he was reading was this. Like a sheep, he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he opens not his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth. Austin Ridge, what is that text talking about? Who is that text talking about? Jesus. But this man didn't understand that. Well, wait a minute. This man went to the right people in the right place and asked the right questions. The light was turned off. This man had no clue who this was talking about. How do we know he has no clue? Look at the next verse. And the eunuch said to Philip, about whom, I ask you, does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else? Is Isaiah referring to himself? Is he talking about another prophet? Philip, is he talking about you? I don't understand what this text is talking about. And I love that Philip is going to open his mouth and explain what is going on. Can the Spirit of God open someone's eyes? Absolutely. Can the Spirit of God open the eyes of an Ethiopian eunuch? Can the Spirit of God open the eyes of an outside linebacker? Can the Spirit of God open the eyes of whoever you're praying for right now? Absolutely. And you may have to be Philip, and you may actually have to open your mouth and speak truth. And here's what Philip's going to do. Let me tell you who Jesus is and what Jesus has done in my life. That's all he's going to tell him. Now go back to the text in Isaiah. I'm going to cut out a couple of things. Like a sheep led to slaughter, like a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he opens not his mouth. Jesus never opened his mouth. He was tried and declared innocent in 6 different occasions during his night of trials. 6 different confessions that I find no wrong in this man. And he does not open his mouth. Now, usually when people get real defensive and wordy, they're guilty, right? Usually when someone's not guilty of what's being accused of them, I don't have to say anything. I'm innocent. Jesus never says a word. Often we get defensive when we know that there's some truth to what's being said. And what's also interesting here, he says, who can describe his generation? What does that mean? Here's what Isaiah is saying. He's literally saying, who can explain to this generation who that man was? Who? Who can do that? Who can talk about this man who lived 30 years and did miracles and we saw amazing things happen and what he spoke was true and the way he said it, it happened exactly the way he said it. Who can explain this man's life? Who can explain that he was crucified on a cross? Who can explain that he was dead, buried, and on the third day rose again, and the tomb was empty, and the Roman guards never saw anyone come in and never saw anyone leave? Who can explain that? And here's the answer biblically. You and I better be the ones, because no one else has the answer. Look to your right, look to your left. Are you impressed? The Bible says that you and I are plan A for getting this message out. There's no plan B. I probably wouldn't have done it that way if I'm God. If I'm God, I probably would have said, here's who I'm going to save. All you guys get over here and don't say a word. You'll mess it up. But that's also what the evil one would say. You just stand there and you say nothing. Here's the question. If God can die standing there saying nothing, can we stand there and say something? And Philip is going to share with this man. Verse 35, then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning with the scripture, he told him the good news about Jesus. I love the fact that Philip does not try to pontificate for an hour about the prophet Isaiah because it's very complex. Here's what Philip does. Well, let me tell you what he's saying. Now, let me tell you about Jesus. That's all it is to share with someone. Here's what my life was like before I encountered Christ. Here's how my life changed. And here's how my life's been like since. It's not the same. I'm not who I used to be. I'm not who I'm going to be. And I'm never going back. Jesus has changed my life. That's your testimony video like we heard today. That's your story. There's nothing more powerful in all of witnessing, all through the scriptures, than a Christian talking about how Jesus changed their life. And that's what Philip says. Let me tell you the good news about Jesus. Verse 36, as they were going along the road, they came to some water. Now, I haven't been to a lot of deserts. I don't know if this was a pool, if this was a fountain. I don't know if this was a river. I don't know why there's water there. They're going. There's no coincidence. A certain man on a certain day reading a certain text, and you're going to be at a certain place. And when you get to a certain point in that conversation, there's going to be, for certain, coincidentally, some water. Look what happens. See, here is water. What prevents me from being baptized? That may be the greatest question in the Bible. What prevents you today from trusting in Christ? Here's what the Bible says. Nothing can separate you from the love of God. Nothing prevents you. Yeah, but you don't know where I've been. You don't know what I've done. You don't know what I thought. You don't know what I used to do. Doesn't matter. God knows. God knows more about you than I know, so it doesn't matter what I know. Nothing separates you from the love of God, the scriptures clearly says. You know what separates someone from trusting in Christ? They do. Themselves. That's what separates. That's what prevents them. The Bible says nothing prevents you from trusting in Christ. Just you. We get asked that question again of, can anyone come here? Everyone is welcome to come to Austin Ridge. I don't necessarily care what your background is, what you used to do, what you do now. We just want you to understand who Jesus is. We want you to understand. Because if you understand, it changes your life. How many Easters, non-believer, have you celebrated? Oh, many. How many Christmas Eves, non-Christian, have you celebrated? Many. Do you understand? Do you understand? Because if someone doesn't understand, they don't understand. They're not clear on who Jesus is. Because if they were, it wouldn't just be another Easter. It wouldn't just be another Christmas Eve. It would be life-altering. And just like this man, what prevents me from being baptized right here, right now? Now, the next verse after 36 in your Bible, what's the next verse in the text there? What number is it? 38. Some of you may have 37, some of you don't. What happened to 37? You got to come back next week, I'll tell you. In the most reliable New Testament manuscripts, verse 37 is not included. Now, then they didn't have verses like chapters and verses like we have. We add those later for ease. Can you imagine I'm saying, hey, I'm somewhere about a third of the way into Acts right now. Turn to it. It'd be hard to find. Verse 37 was added later. Now, in a lot of manuscripts, verse 37 is here. Here's what it says. It doesn't change anything about the context and doesn't change verse 38 whatsoever. Here's what verse 37 says. Have you loved the Lord with all your heart? Philip asked this eunuch. He says, I believe Jesus is the Son of God. That's verse 37. That's what's said. Does not change at all what's about to happen in verse 38. Look what happens. And he commanded the chariot to stop. And they both went down into the water, Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized them here. I baptized a lot of people. We have a baptism over here on the floor. I don't even have to get wet. I baptize people over a wall. I baptize them in the wall. He gets in the water and baptizes this man. Here's what I love about this man. What prevents me from being baptized? There's water. Stop the chariot. Here's what he's saying. I don't care about my career in Ethiopia. I don't care about my position and whether I keep it or not. I will not live one more moment without having clarity who the Lord is and why the fact that the tomb is empty should matter to me and be the most important thing in my life. Stop the chariot. If people understand who Jesus is in their life, they say, hold everything. I don't want to live another day without walking with the Lord, the lover of my soul. Go back with me. He went down the water, Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. Verse 39. And when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord carried Philip away. Now, again, I baptized a lot of people. That's never happened for me. So when I baptized someone dead and buried with Christ, raised to walk, it would be awesome to turn around. I'm gone, right? So where did Philip go? Well, the text tells you. Look at the next part, verse 40. And Philip found himself at Azotus. So let me tell you what Philip just did. Philip is literally, he leaves Jerusalem. He goes to Samaria, which is north. He's sharing the gospel with Samaria in chapter 7 and early chapter 8, I should say. And then he's told by the angel of the Lord to go south, not just south, far south, far south. He baptizes this Ethiopian eunuch who he just met. He disappears, and all of a sudden, that word carried away literally means rapture. He is raptured away, and all of a sudden, he ends up in a place called Azotus, which in our Old Testament, we know is a Philistine city called Ashdod. The Philistine city where they do not like Jewish people. And then Philip, can you imagine being Philip? He's baptized this guy, pulls him up, and all of a sudden, he's in a Philistine city. And what does he do once he gets to Ashdod? He starts telling everybody about Jesus. See, here's what's awesome about Philip. Wherever you put him, he just talks about Jesus. Doesn't matter where he is. Doesn't matter if he's in Samaria. Doesn't matter if he's in Ashdod. Doesn't matter if it's an Ethiopian eunuch. It's just people, and they all need Jesus. He just tells people about Jesus. I love Philip. Later, Philip is going to go further north again, and he's going to meet a guy, we know him as Saul, who changes his name to Paul, and he becomes a partner with Paul. This man is faithful. And he baptizes him, pulls him up. He's carried away, and the eunuch saw him no more and went on his way rejoicing. He had just been in Samaria. If you read the earlier part of chapter 8, which we'll be to in a couple of weeks in our study in Acts, he went to Samaria. He shared Jesus in Samaria, and people were rejoicing. Now the Ethiopian eunuch is rejoicing. Why? Because when people get clarity on who Jesus is, it brings great joy. And this Ethiopian eunuch goes home rejoicing. We have a church father, Irenaeus, has said historically, history tells us that this man then goes back to Ethiopia and becomes a missionary to the people in Ethiopia, and a great revival in Ethiopia happened. And I believe generations of Christians today in Ethiopia are Christians today because of this man's faithfulness on a road in the middle of nowhere doing nothing, and a guy runs up and catches the chariot, and his name's Philip. Folks, this is what we get to do. This is what it means to be a Christian. Wherever God puts you, you talk about Jesus. And here's what's important. The number one reason why I say to someone, do you go to a local church? They say, no. And here's the number one reason. I say, why not? Because I know Christians. That's the number one answer, because I know Christians. I don't like Christians. Or maybe you get this answer. Well, I don't like organized religion. You ever heard that? I don't like organized religion. You need to know, we do this every week. If you come back, I'm not going to have a suit on next week. But if you come back, I don't like religion. I don't like organized religion. I'm not a religious person. I believe in a true spirituality of following a person. It is the most rebellious, on the edge, countercultural thing you could ever imagine, is following Jesus, where you're rubbing the fur the wrong direction and everyone else is going the other way. We don't need wimpy people. We need radicals who follow Jesus in a culture that says that's just a bunch of mess that you create to make yourself feel better. No, that's what the world does. They create things in this mess to make you feel better. We have an answer. We don't have to feel better. We are good because we have an answer for death. Amen? Amen? And so we do this every week. And again, when someone says, I don't like organized religion, I don't like Christians, great, because I'm not asking you to follow Christians. I'm not asking you to follow church. I'm asking you to follow Jesus. Now, we do believe that his people are called to gather, and that's why we gather here weekly. And it's kind of like, go back to football. I'm sorry, I like sports. Go back to football. We gather as a huddle here on Sunday mornings. We call a play, and you guys go execute the play. Sometimes some of you fumble. Sometimes you score a touchdown. Sometimes you get sacked. You come back. We huddle again. We call another play. And we will do this till Jesus comes back. Are you with me? Amen. So, guys, this for us is not a holiday. It's not about a certain event on a calendar. This is about being a Christian in a culture and being like Philip and saying, this is Jesus. Let me help you understand. So my question this morning is, I think this is our last service. I think so. For this week. My question this morning is, might there be one person in the foyer, in Building A, even in the balcony, Dripping Springs, Southwest Campus, what prevents you from trusting Christ today? What prevents you? What more can he do? He gives you the breath that you use to breathe in your lungs. He watched over you as you slept last night. You had nothing to do with that. He has preserved you. At times we have cursed him. He continues to pursue us. At times we rebel against him. He continues to provide for us the things we need to continue to live. What would prevent someone today trusting in the Lord, the lover of their souls, so they can know for all eternity how they're going to spend the rest of their life. Might there be one person? I'm going to pray with you now, and I'm going to pray, and there's nothing magical about a prayer. There's no spiritual dust I can sprinkle on you for your eyes to be open. There's no card to fill out, but I'm going to pray with you kind of the prayer that I prayed with those football players that I mentioned. And if there's one person here that maybe the Lord has worked in your heart and you're ready, you can pray along with me, and the Lord will start doing the work in your life that only he can pull off, so that he gets all the glory and all the credit, and you too get to have insider trading. Amen? Pray with me. Father, I can think of no better time than Easter for someone, one person, who is tired of the emptiness this life brings, is tired of the loneliness this life brings, is tired of the struggle with addiction, is tired of dealing with pride, tired of dealing with anger, tired of dealing with resentment and bitterness, tired of just being tired. May there be one person this morning that your heart grabbed their heart today and they would respond by praying to you, Lord, I know that I'm a sinner. I didn't need a preacher to tell me that this morning. I know that. I know that there's things in my life that aren't right. I know I've dishonored you at times. I know I've displeased you at times. But Lord, if what this preacher is saying and the tomb is empty, would you forgive me of my sins? Would you enter my heart? Would you change my life? Would you overwhelm me with your presence? Would you convict me? Would you change me? I don't think this world has the answers. I think you do. I believe you're the Son of God. I believe the tomb is empty. And on this Easter, would you enter my heart and change my life? And Lord, if there's one person that prayed that prayer today, go ahead and tell them they need a seatbelt, because you're about to take them on a ride. Lord, I pray for us that have known you for a while, that you would embolden us with the desire and the passion and the love for people that Philip has, that we would open our mouths. More importantly, we would live our lives in a way that would draw people to you. And Lord, if there's one person that prayed that, that they would tell someone on our staff, someone with a badge in the lobby, just someone, I prayed that prayer today, and they would continue to come, and we continue to help them grow. Lord, thank you for what you did Friday on the cross. I can't imagine. And thank you that this morning the tomb was empty. And we pray that we'd realize that every day is Easter for the Christian. It's in your lovely and beautiful and powerful name we pray, the name of Jesus. Amen.
Church, you sing, who could imagine?
Who could imagine?
Thank you.
Again, thank you for spending your time with us. If you brought a kid, you have to take him with you. Do not leave your kids here. We like to give a challenge after Easter, and here's the challenge. Would you be willing to come back 4 weeks if coming to church is not your normal routine? 4 weeks. Would you come the next 4 weeks? We're going to dive back in the book of Acts. I'll be right back in it next week. Would you give 4 weeks to see what God wants to do in your life, how he wants to speak to you? And if week five you're not enjoying it, we'll see you at Christmas Eve. No problem. We do this every week, 9/11. Love to have you. Let me pray us out. Lord, thank you for these amazing people who are willing to come and spend time with us today and to be nice in the parking lot afterwards. We're so grateful. We're so grateful for you. So grateful for what this day means for us, that we are free and we have true life that will last forever. Thank you, Jesus. And thank you for these men and women. As we dismiss them, may you overwhelm them. May you put them in front of other people that need to understand and give them the words to say as they are Philip. It's in your name we pray. Amen.